This is Babbage Babbage, and this is a lecture, as you see here, from the topic of Greek legacies, mimesis, beauty, and form. And there's a number of background readings. You can see this in the literal background. Plato, and that includes his Ion, Phaedrus, Symposium, but also his Republic, Aristotle's Poetics, and so on. And the text I'm going to be looking at will be Fokker Benz, Rock Sample, Thomas Prüfer, Provenance and Imitation, Shiner, The Greeks Had No Word for It, and so on. And also I'm going to talk a little bit about, right down here, Michael Fried's Antiquity Now, and possibly a bit of Mersch if we get to that, on aesthetic thinking. Other thinkers included to be discussed and very relevant will be Nahamas, the Plato or Schopenhauer, and Michael Newman, The Specificity of Criticism and Its Need for Philosophy Along with Fiat's Shadows of Theory. One of the more intriguing aspects, there was a bit of peak there ahead, a philosophical reflection on aesthetics, is that it can be difficult to situate the ancients while, and of course, as is a common in philosophy, the ancients can never be utterly excluded. Here we see Jeff Koons's sculpture and the Renaissance reimagining of antiquity that was already reimagined in the Renaissance, now again reimagined with Koons, using nothing more than a garden variety, garden gazing ball. There's a lot to say about the American sculptor born in Pennsylvania. He was born in New York in 1955, but Koons is mostly relevant in this context as a mimetic artist. He makes a lot of copies, and he makes them, and this does show how easy it can be to do so on an industrial scale. Here, the question is, what is mimesis? The word is Greek. To illustrate that, I think here, right, mimesis, you see this, an illustration of the Dionysian mystery myth, as Thracian Maenads. This is what this is imitating, tor or phaos, limb from limb. So we see this is a Roman mimesis of this original Greek myth depicting the rending of Pentheus, as the Romans would have known him by tragic representation, as we remember Pentheus's disastrous end at the hands of his mother. Perhaps that's his mother, maybe this one is, it's unclear, in the Bacchae by Euripides. Nietzsche calls Euripides a decadent, tragic poet, and therefore a poor witness to the Greek tradition. He comes too late, so it's already over, Nietzsche would argue. How did the Greeks originally understand mimesis? To begin to answer, we need the resources of philology, that's classical studies, classics as we call them, studies of the theater, obviously. But above all, I would remind us, we will need to know something about theology, Greek religious ritual, and that would be a kind of archaeoethnography, as mimesis would have been part of such a rite and therefore a sacrificial context. It would do something. We speak of this, we call this a myth, but it was an enacted and thus active part of Greek civic or political life, including philosophy as a way of life, as Pierre Hadot speaks of it, or practice. Here again, the question of equivocation that we've already foregrounded with respect to the need to distinguish philosophical aesthetics and art history or art criticism, or what the Germans, we talked about this previously, called Kunst. Wissenschaft in general, quite apart from art as such, that is objectively or as defined by art collectors and curators housed in museums, art galleries, and the like. We're going to mention that just in a moment. In the philosophy of art, we have such a pragmatic or stipulative or operative definition, that of the American philosopher of art, George Dickey, who very conventionally defines art by way of such institutions, pretty much as if to say that art is what you find in a museum, telling us that, I quote here, and here we have a depiction of the of what would have been the ritual event of the mysteries. For Dickey, more Dionysian mysteries, a work of art in the classificatory sense is, I put that in bold, one, an artifact, it's a thing, or it's a set of the aspects of which has had conferred upon it the status of candidate for appreciation by some person or persons acting on behalf of a certain social institution, and he puts that in parentheses, the art world. This definition of art functions by way of stipulative convention, and Dickey appropriately refers to prior philosophical debates, notably Morris Weitz or Weitz, The Role of Theory in Aesthetics, adumbrated via Maurice Mandelbaum's reflections on the challenge of defining art. You see here is the anatomy of historical knowledge, but he also wrote on defining art, sort of both of them are kind of proto-Cavellians, with respect to Wittgenstein's reflections on the challenge of defining a game. Now, Weitz, as we see, reflected pre-Cavell, before Cavell did it, on Shakespeare and philosophy, and Mandelbaum wrote on history, right, as we see there, as well as art. There are elements of Gilbert Ryle's collective or emergent sampling in his reflection on the identity of the university. This is a long quote here, I won't read, in Dickey's institutional definition of art. And Dickey also defers to Arthur Danto's liminally atmospheric, we can barely read that here, something the eye cannot descry. That's what Danto says. Definition of the art world. What art is going to be is going to involve something you can't see. Now, we're going to talk about Danto. Here we see Danto in, I think this is his Riverside, pretty sure it's his Riverside Drive apartment. He was, I know, because he subscribed to New Nietzsche Studies, and so he was on the bottom floor, and it was a dress, but a little later in the term. But Danto means by the art world, we see here, not only the collectors and the galleries, but also the curatorial dimension, as this is manifest in who does and who does not manage to be known as an artist. And we remember that Danto was famous for, in effect, having made Andy Warhol famous. All of this may serve as a background for Larry Shiner's reflections in his chapter, The Invention of Art is the name of the book, but the chapter we're reading is The Greeks Had No Word for It. It can also be traced in Fried's reflections, Antiquity Now, which will be a reflection, a chance for us, sorry, we're reading this, to be able to go back to Winckelmann's Gedanken über die Nachahmung, the imitation of Greek works in painting and sculpture. In addition, although this also will take us to the concerns not merely of art history. I should say that this text appeared in 1986 in October, and we are already up to 172 as that continues to be issued. It's an iconic journal. But critical and cultural theory, there's the question of the role of the artist qua technites. We'll be talking about that for the Greeks and the distinction between what we today take the artist to be. This reflection also echoes in Fried and in Frauke Berndt in her reflections. Here we have the title of her essay, Rock Sample, on Baumgarten's epistemologically and metaphysically minded considerations in his Aesthetica. I don't expect to be able to do more than touch on this last theme in the current lecture, but there's also Adorno on Mimesis, connected typically as Adorno himself makes the connection with Walter Benjamin's essay on technical reproducibility. But here, we need above all in the current context to return, that's why this is a matter of legacy, to the Greeks to understand what they meant by this notion. Here it's going to matter to note that we have to go back before Aristotle to Plato, and before Plato to the poets themselves. As Plato already intimates, it's part of his agonistic reflection on the relation between philosophy and poetry to Homer and Pindar. And if Nietzsche is correct, and in order to understand the dithyram, which Nietzsche argued was essential to understand Aeschylus and Sophocles, Archilochus, as the poetic servant, Musundina of Dionysus. Above all, to understand mimesis as ritual, and we're still doing this in many religions to this day, do this in memory of me, we also need the Orphic. Vision of Orpheus is a complicated one, but it is yoked to the image of art and poetry and music and its power. Thus, we may note the pre-Raphaelite depiction here, I have it, of Orpheus as remnant, this is what's left of him, in John Waterhouse's gloss of Milton's poetic mansion. What could the muse herself whom Orpheus bore, the muse herself for her enchanting son, whom universal nature did lament, when, by the rout that made the hideous roar, his gory visage down the stream was sent, down the swift Tethys to the Lesbian shore. That's Milton's Lycidas, circa 1637, as the poet tells us himself. The Waterhouse rendering dates from 1900, nymphs finding the head of Orpheus, the year Nietzsche died, the year Gadamer was born. To return to the complex meaning of this origin, this legacy is clearly complex and much debated, if most of the debate takes place among literary critical approaches. And the meaning of the word, as already suggested, mimesis, varies in the same degree. Here we can see circa, we can see that there, 1884. And so contemporary, at least in his lifetime, with Nietzsche himself, William Bouguereau, the youth, la naissance, the youth of Bacchus. This is very beautiful, very romantic. And Alexander Nahamas rightly celebrates another painting by Bouguereau, nude seated by the sea, as I do, but kind of a different nude, in my Hallelujah effect. But this youth of Bacchus is rather a dose, as Bouguereau can tend to be, of sweetness and light, as the festivities depicted involved extraordinary cruelty. We have, go back to this, in the collapsed Maenad, only a delicately pictured, hinted at image of some of that, but the brutality of these sparagmos you can see on this crater, this animal being torn into, actually, literally in half, and on the Scylax also here, which plainly enough also would depict Pentheus. You see his entrails, it's very, very awful, because the ladies handling him, it's a very gory image, are ladies of the court, very sedately dressed for Maenads, or very recently one might also consider a contemporary neoclassical painting by Leonid Ilyukin, Man Choosing Between Apollo and Dionysus, that was finished as a master's project, he tells us, in 2018, which replicates pre-Raphaelite images of both Anglo and Russian modalities, there are both types, along with aspects of Poussin and more Raphael right there than one usually finds in the pre-Raphaelites. That means more mimesis. Here at stake is less than a Hegelian either-or of the choice, choosing between, as the Greek Dionysia was a matter of ritual originally associated with folk practices and associated also with a particular procession or dance. That would be the Trugoidea, sometimes translated as the goat dance, and here we can see Dionysus, that would be the Dionysus figure with, on either side, satyrs and a Maenad carrying a thyrsus. In Basel, the ritual dramatic representation can be seen on a 480 BCE Cato, this is a red figure, column Cato, but imitating the dance is one thing, and representing the god another. Here we have the with various garlands and dedication. So we could note Michelangelo Merisi da Caravaggio, which is usually how we know him in his representation, is a little threat there of Bacchus, circa 1596 as well. And there's some sense of the same edge or tension that we experience in Euripides in the Bacchic drinking scene depicted in Diego Velázquez's Los Borrachos, 1628-29, and you can see that in the Prado in Madrid. As mimesis, the entire rite may itself be regarded as mimetic recollection or celebration of the destruction as Zagreus and rebirth of Dionysus. As Zeus, gives birth to Dionysus, who was first torn limb from limb as a goddess at the hands of the Titan gods, and reborn, this is this great imitation here, from his father's thigh. And here too we also see Hermes ready to whisk him away to safety, a little bit playing of nanny. He plays mommy and he plays nanny. The Dionysia are part of a death cult, rites in which philosophy also plays a role, as we read in Plato's Republic and also in the Phaedrus. All of this unfurls a world, for the most part, forgotten in the best and most permanent fashion. That works because official stories have come to stand in place of whatever antiquity there may have been to tell us what to think. Thus, Aristotle and Plato have already told us what to think about myth and tragedy in general, and the poets in particular, and Plato especially, mimesis to boot. In this way, the focus, as is necessary in philosophical aesthetics, is theoretical and narrative knowledge and truth. Even Nietzsche contrasts art and truth. Echoing Aristotle, Plato amicus said, Plato is a friend, but, and Nietzsche uses the phrase here, and I'm translating it, not this, but for his university lecture courses, you can find them in KGW 2, volume 4, on page 3, the lectures offered intermittently almost throughout his entire career from 1872 to 1879, when he took early retirement. Plato and his predecessors, amicus said, this friend, but. Now, Nietzsche says it's an attempt, and he explains that it's intended to be useful to those who wish to read Plato and therefore regard it as necessary or needful to prepare. In this way, philosophy declares its fealty to its predecessors or forebears while underlining an overweening love of truth above all. Thus Aristotle's amicus Plato said, same said Nietzsche uses, magis amica veritas, confesses that one cannot help sacrificing one's feelings of love for one's friend in favor of one's love for the truth, who is also a kind of greater friend, and one will be a greater friend to the truth in turn. It can be useful to remember that one may not define philosophy, the love of wisdom, as the love of truth, where wisdom is so notoriously difficult to define that Socrates refuses the accolade of the wisest of men, of human beings, of mortals, thereby echoing, and this too is mimesis, Thales, famously the first of the wise men or the philosophers, who refused, very importantly, the title symbolized by that gift of a tripod, which Thales passed along to Solon, give it to him, who, as Nietzsche reminds us of this tale, it's told in Plutarch's Lives, emphatically set the script for Socrates, if we recall Socrates' reprisal of the same deflection in Plato's Apology, by saying, as Solon, very wise, is said to have replied, only the god is wise. Send to Delphi for an answer. To this extent, the Apology is itself a mimesis quite on the issues of mimetic claims to knowledge, and we go on now to Bernton Baumgarten. In her literally titled Reflections, for example, Alexander Gottlieb Baumgarten, the German literary theorist currently teaching in Zurich, Volker Bernd, reminds us that Baumgarten's epistemology of the aesthetic is based on literary texts, thus simultaneously inventing, she says, modern literary theory. At the same time, it's essential to remember the disciplinary framework, 17th and 18th century, of the era in which Baumgarten writes his Aesthetica, after Leibniz and Wolff, including, we pointed to that before, its own court focus and political sensibilization, the role and place of the faculties in the university, which is key to Deleuze's discussion of Kant. And one may also trace this in Foucault, who elevates a certain attention in addition to the faculties of medicine and law, along with mathematics and physics, to what are now the supposed inferior cognitive faculties lifted up, theoretically speaking. It's in this line up that we at least in this text, are going to be looking at the aesthetica mediology of rhetoric and poetics, that both of these are texts from Aristotle. We've already noted the importance of the ancients, and one cannot attend to what Ben calls mediology, otherwise rhetoric and poetics, without referring to Aristotle. The upshot gives us the invention of aesthetics as ideal. This isn't a one-off, which is why Berndt explicates this by speaking of Baumgarten's upgrading of the aesthetic experience of art to an epistemologically relevant subject of philosophy, and she tells us that that revolutionized epistemology. Suddenly, art opened up an alternative path for human understanding of the world. Even, she adds, if we take Baumgarten seriously, the ideal path. With this upgrade, what's effectively introduced is a kind of contradiction in terms. As far as the ancients, such as Plato or Parmenides, might have been concerned, veritas, aestheticological truth, that would be truth and logic via, that's where the paradox comes in, the senses. If we no longer find this a radical claim, it only betrays the extent to which we today, like Nietzsche, are no longer friends of Plato, its friends, but the extent to which even Aristotle's definition of truth will have been firmly brought down to earth, as Raphael's School of Athens illustrates this by a famous pronation of Aristotle's hands. Plato, of course, as we know, on the other side, I guess it's over on that side, would be pointing, it is on this side, would be pointing to the heaven of the forms, while Aristotle brings things down to earth. The tour, so Baumgarten's logical overture here is revelatory. Taxo de Latin, or by the, I think I have that, let's see, objective metaphysics, metaphysica objectiva, may be opposed to subjective metaphysics, metaphysica subjectiva, which indeed has gained new virtues post-Descartes, but also post-Leibniz, such that one may define these are all to be understood as so many species or kinds of truth, intellectual truth, veritas mentalis, as the truth of influence, which rhetorical dimensionality echoes or underlies an ideal. We're still speaking of mimesis of correspondence or conformity, veritas efficientiae correspondentiae et conformitatis. Berndt is clear, you see how they are arrayed, that this is a kind of intellectual skyhook. She says aesthetico-logical is the neologism, more precisely the magic word Baumgarten hopes will save him from paradox. She gives the examples of sunflowers. And one wonders if she might also have made reference to the important role of the sun for Plato and his Republic and its influential myth of the cave, of fabrication and of indirect and therefore lesser copies, copies that are remove from the ideal or the true. As already pointed out, the epistemology Baumgarten coins for his aesthetic is fundamentally based on literary text. Plato's Republic is also a literary text. And it is useful for a theorist of literature to note that this, as Ben says, invents modern literary theory. But the reflection is also key for Derrida. And to this day, we mentioned him in class, the Belgian theorist of technology teaching media theory and philosophy in Vienna, Mark Kirkelberg, likewise reflects on the relevance of 18th and 19th century thinking, relevant for our understanding of both technology today and the aesthetic image of the cyborg. Think Frankenstein in Kirkelberg's 2017 book, New Romantic Cyborgs. For her part, reflecting on Baumgarten, Berndt observes that phenomena of this kind are the sensual dimension of literary language, especially figures and tropes and their performativity, phonetic and rhythmic elements in particular, as well as the graphics of visual figures. She says, gives us the Latin here, expressiones figurarum lusus sic literarum. Here, both literally and the focus on literality is essential to this, and analogically, and that's the focus on the metaphor, are going to be instructively combined to side Baumgarten himself. And this is what Berndt does. For my part, I believe that it's entirely apparent to philosophers that whatever particular form of perfection in thought and logical truth is present can only have been acquired with the loss of much and great material perfection. For what is abstraction if not a loss? That's from the aesthetic, and we have the Latin. In this way, Baumgarten, in his Collegium über the aesthetic, can define what becomes quite significant for our definition of science such to this day. And note that this is very different from both ancient and medieval notions of science, but utterly in accord with modern science, such that Baumgarten can claim Wissenschaft von allem, was sinnlich ist, what is sensible, what can be felt. This is, Berndt goes on to explain, the upshot shifts the focus from discursive concepts to an elementary rhetorical and dialectical procedure. Aesthetics, as Baumgarten explains, I'm still quoting Berndt, is an epistemological art analogous to reason. And this takes her to her title reference. And I actually have here, just as an illustration, I have a rock, an uncut rock. It's actually been fractured, but it's not been cut. Very, very significant. So what she means by this, she says, the aesthetic experience. Okay. Here's a question of literal abstraction, the moving, taking away, loss. In the case of Michelangelo, as is famously recounted, and again, the notion of reduction, taking away, removal. So if we cite Baumgarten himself, that was the slide that wanted to come a little early, by similar reasoning, one cannot produce a marble globe out of irregularly shaped marble, at least not without such a loss of material that the price of roundness will be quite high. The piece could be big, but if I were to make a globe, turn this into a quartz sphere, it'd be quite tiny. As Berndt explains, Baumgarten isn't interested in the uncut rock, not for the problem of the ideas that are innate to the marble block. It's not a matter of the quartz. He's also not interested in the aesthetic relationship between rock and the plastic arts, which is suddenly under discussion with Leibniz's Hercules, and which Winckelmann expands upon in his famous text, Beschreibung des Torso im Belvedere zu Rom, which is the description of the Belvedere torso in Rome. As Berndt clarifies the point, and we may now be able set up to note a connection with Michael Fried's discussion of Winckelmann and Michelangelo, which we're going to get to below, as Berndt writes, what interests Baumgarten about the rock is its material as such, or more provocatively expressed, he's interested, this is a Lacanian point, in the real, the material remains which constitute the real truth. Okay. The connective association, that's the reference, the metonymic resonance, the echo of Lacan, is key. And at this point, we can step back just to keep our own focus on philosophical aesthetics, because as Berndt emphasizes, and this is perhaps the clearest parallel with Plato and appearance, there is no aesthetic theory without the aesthetic phenomenon. And that lets us know we're speaking Greek, phenomenon. Thomas Prüfer takes a related approach. In his essay on Providence and Imitation, you can compare Sophocles' Oedipus with Aristotle's Poetics, recounting the myth as such, as the account of King Oedipus, and detailing, as it were, the plot, to speak with Aristotle, Prüfer tells us what happened and emphasizes Sophocles' account as representation of the myth. Here, one can also contrast, this is the story that's told, this with Pier Pasolini's famous 1967 film, Edipo Rey. You can see the same image we saw there in the background with Kit Daran, here on the film poster that then becomes a video box. And now, of course, it's just an image. Prüfer retells all the points Oedipus Rex, including the Anagnorisis, the recognition. We see here Odysseus sitting here with his crutch, appearing as an aged man, incompetent, and obviously about to do serious damage. And then there's Oedipus. To quote Prufer, in deprecation of all oracles, Jocasta focuses on the Odyssey, tells in Homer, we see that here, but on Oedipus, here, this is Oedipus after Oedipus Rex, after he has been blinded or blinded himself and cast himself out. So back to Oedipus and Antigone, and this is Brodowski, 1828. She says, dismissing everything, it's a that none of these can be true, since that's also already very, very prevalent in antiquity, that the oracle foretelling the death of Laios was false, because Laios was killed by no one who would count as his son, not by his own son, but by foreign robbers at a place where two roads become one, or it's ambiguous, one road becomes two, depends how you're going. And Oedipus remembers that on his way from Delphi to Thebes, he killed in anger with a staff at just such a place. And there's disquiet and there's recognition. After making this distinction, Prufer predictably asks, this is after Jocasta takes her life in Pasolini, what is the difference between the story of Oedipus and the work Oedipus? And this would be either Sophocles or Pasolini. In the tragedy, the events are not narrated, they're presented, more exactly, they're represented, they're not spoken about, but displayed. More exactly, they're played. This is mimesis. Here's the question of the work. This is the performative point of being played at issue. Although Prufer's reference is Aristotle, is the distinction Plato makes between diegesis and mimesis. But Prufer cites Aristotle's mimesis of Plato. As in imitation of action, it limits the indefinite context of antecedent and concurrent and consequent actions, and it tightens the episodic sequence of actions to a pattern, a syntax. The language is systasis, synthesis, and orderedness. The result is a completeness to which nothing can be added, and from which nothing can be taken away, an articulated whole, neither too large nor too small, to be well taken in altogether by a gaze or a look. The Greek is eusynopton, carrying everything together, together as a whole. The issue of the theistic reflection as evidence in Prufer's title reference to Providence is clear in myth as such. The gods mind human affairs. Human affairs have the look of being looked at by the look of the gods. This is the motif as this appears on Greek ships. This is a recreation with one such eye. And as we can also see this on the 530 BCE, Chalcidian black figure kilix, or drinking cup. This is a drinking vessel, we might say. We can also recall, as this is relevant in philosophy, Socrates and his remarks early in the Republic on the apotropaic significance. He's talking about Thrasymachus's aggressive style of attack, of seeing in advance. If I hadn't seen this wolf, as it were, he says, I would have been frozen, which may also be related to reflection or seeing that one is being seen. By contrast, and here Prufer makes it clear that he's following, as most literary reflections follow, Aristotle. This is the quote, it's clear. Aristotle, after recalling the opinion that the gods see all things, rejects the allogon, the non-rational in events, insofar as they are represented in the well-made tragedy, just as he bans from representation in the plot events related to one another by, we could say, mere chance. As ever, and that's why Aristotle's influence continues to this day, Aristotle's the antipode to Nietzsche on the same question. For Aristotle, there's no non-human gaze, no divine gaze, no gaze of the gods in and for and through which the scatteredness and the indefiniteness and the fortuitousness, that is the unintelligibility of human affairs, are drawn into intelligibility. That display of unity and definition and necessity for which there is no better word than eidos. For Aristotle, the eidos of human affairs is an artificial made, fabricated eidos. The artific- the artifact. What's created is tragedy, the plot that is constructed by the artifice of the poet. That's the end of the quote. The question now leaves us with a distinction between the Greek telling of their own myth and Aristotle's veritably modern account of the same, disenchanted and reduced to a technique. Indeed, in Aristotle's terms, a machine. And this is to this day the way we can look at theatrical effects. An sich, this is a mechane, this is literally the deus ex machina, the god out of the machine. These illustrations that we see here give us the mechanical devices used in theater for the sake of theatrical effect, lifting and lowering, but, and this is also a matter, we can see this here, of wheeling in such divine figures. That's also going to be Alcibiades. See here, the ekikuklema, a version of which was still in use in the 1960s television series Star Trek. I think I have that here, sure. And of course, I hardly need to tell you that size, Gangnam Style, maybe we have that here too, is a mimetic echo. You can just check that out, of just this, and he's a little drunk, image. But it is more, in the current context, relevant to note that Plato gives us sufficient detail, technical detail, in his account of the myth of the cave to permit us to see the mechanism of the representation. We know where the prisoners were, what they could and couldn't see, why not, where the lighting is coming from, the ascent, what's above, and so on. And of course, in Aristophanes' The Clause, Socrates is depicted as being literally out of it, suspended from, and you could see it, that was part of the joke, the machine, as a means to both illustrate and mock the mechanism of such effects. This too is mimesis. As Pooper puts it, and later we're going to reflect on the significance of framing, not later in this lecture, but later in the term, that this also entails, glossing Aristotle, who's the authority to this day, that the machine is outside the representation drama. That's why Aristophanes is showing you it, is making fun of it, either having happened before, but being such that they couldn't humanly be known, or having not yet happened and being noble only by prophecy. For we hold that all things are seen by the gods. There should be nothing, Aristotle says, we note this again, allogon in the events, that's allogon, or if there be, let it be outside the representation, tragoidia, as in Oedipus of Sophocles. It's necessary, this is Aristotle, to imitate the skilled makers of likenesses. We see that again when we get to Plotinus. They reproduce the proper features, or the look of the originals at the same time, making them look more beautiful than that cited in proof. We go on to Larry Shiner, The Invention of Art. This distinction, as Aristotle continues to be influential, is what occupies Larry Shiner, who goes on, and he, since he wrote this book, he's written another one, Art Sense, Exploring the Aesthetics of Smell and the Olfactory Arts, laying claim to smelling. And we should remember that Nietzsche also tells us this, connecting in perfect articulation of philosophical aesthetics, as Nietzsche does, smelling what tasting with knowledge, as Nietzsche fulfills the physiology of his own day and our own, because Nietzsche is really one of the first to tell us that there's no representation or mimesis when it comes to smell. One doesn't have to do, as in the case of sight, with a copy of a smell, as it were, or hearing. When one smell, or feeling even, when one smells a rose or a synthetic version of the rose one smells, and a good nose, as the French say, that nation of perfumers and of taste in the most literal of ways via cheeses and wines, can tell a good nose the difference between natural and synthetic rose, one wine and another. The difference, a sense can be precise, the sense of smell, down to, so olfactory experiments show, down to the molecule, so there's a direct connection between the nose and the brain. There's nothing in between. In Shiner's chapter, The Greeks Had No Word for It, he reminds us that for most of us, going to a performance of Antigone, this is Juliette Binoche, is an art experience like going to the symphony or ballet on a Saturday night. But when the ancient Athenians first witnessed Antigone, they did so as part of a religious political festival, the annual city Dionysia. China's repeating a hamankola, as many are, and rightly so, but the point remains, and it's key, as so it's already been made before Kola in the 50s and Nietzsche's The Birth of Tragedy. Not that China adverts to this. And one has to note, this is also part of the difference between the continental and the analytic, that analytic philosophers of art can tend to have an allergy when it comes to citing Nietzsche, an allergy that extended to Arthur Danto, who condensed his own allergy into the tiny little word, powerfully different word in his book, Nietzsche as Philosophy, wrote it in 1965, in deliberately echoing 65 years earlier about Hans Weyinger's turn of the century book of the same title in German, Nietzsche as Philosoph, Nietzsche as Philosopher. Riffing between art, techne, and as, Scheiner writes, the word we often translate as art was techne, which, like the Roman ars, included many things as diverse as carpentry and poetry, shoemaking and medicine, sculpture and horsebreaking. In fact, techne and ars referred less to a class of objects than to the human ability to make and perform. Scheiner seeks to clarify this generic equivocation as common to philosophy. He thinks that philosophers are mostly the ones who are guilty of this, he says. Many philosophers and historians persist in anachronistically talking of Plato's or Aristotle's idea of fine art and suggests that neither Aristotle or Plato treated painting, sculpture, architecture, poetry, music as belonging to a single distinct category called art. The ancient practice, always cited as foreshadowing our idea of fine art, is the treatment of painting, epic and tragedy, as arts of imitation. That word again, mimesis, that's page 20 in the PDF that you can have read. I hope you read. It is mimesis that we're speaking of here, imitation, as Schein is on very secure ground, as he cites Eric Havelock to support his title claim, in defiance of the fact that neither art nor artist, as we use the words, is translatable into archaic or high classical Greek. Although Scheiner may overstep his claims, Heidegger will contest part of the emphasis he makes. Art goes on to say, and we can see some of the similar point, we should not exaggerate the parallel between Aristotle's distinctions and our own. The verb form for poetizing, poiein, for example, means simply to make, with none of our overtones of romantic creativity. The issue crosses over to more critical theoretical reflection on class and the role of art, but also on the concern of the so-called liberal arts and philosophy's contest, beginning with Plato, contra the sophists as a matter of taking money for what you do. One will recall from the Republic that Thrasymachus, remember him, will only debate Socrates. Think of the vaunted debate that took place between Jordan Peterson before his collapse from an overdependence on prescription psychopharmaceuticals, alas, and Slavoj Žižek. The operative issue there, though, was a payday for both participants in the debate. Doesn't matter that the issue was capitalism versus Marxism. The whole thing was a capitalist ploy. The classic class distinction in antiquity concerns the question of the banalsic, that's that word poiein. Only this would be the distinction between what the free man would be. But Scheiner emphasizes this point. The only general classification of the arts in the ancient world that significantly resembled modern ideas was the late Hellenistic and Roman division of the arts into the liberal, free for the free person, for the noble, and the vulgar, or the servile. And that's defined. Those would be those that involve, this is Scheiner's definition, physical labor and or payment, one or the other. Whereas the liberal or free arts were not compensated. They were intellectual and appropriate to the high-born and educated. Although the category of free arts was not a rigid one, the core included the verbal arts, so grammar, rhetoric, and dialectic, and the mathematical arts, of arithmetic. These would be the high arts, geometry, astronomy, and music. You can see why it's literally high. Page 22. Here to continue Shiner's conventional and mainstream analogy of citing Nietzsche, whose own gloss of Plutarch's Lives and his lecture courses on the pre-Platonic philosophers and Plato we already cited, Shiner cites Plutarch, not directly, but via Alison Burford's perfectly apposite for his topic, Craftsmen in Greek and Roman Society. She published that in 1972, and that means you get to skip over Nietzsche, who wrote a full century earlier. Although, this is the citation, the achievements of Greek naturalism in painting and sculpture of the 5th and 4th centuries BCE were much admired for the most part. Painters and sculptors were still viewed as manual workers, and Plutarch's ad that no talented young aristocrat upon seeing and admiring the famous Zeus of Phidias would want to be Phidias. Okay, so to qualify this exemplary ideal for the ears of his then contemporary 19th century audience, which would be ears fairly like our own, Nietzsche cites Plutarch's remonstration against, this is in the Greek state, the Griechische Stadt, our own envy. We could be jealous of the artisan, the artist's skill. Nietzsche writes, no noble-born youth would himself, upon seeing Zeus in Paisa, that would be Zeus, the statue of Zeus, have the desire to become himself Ophidias, or else on seeing Hera in Argos, wish to become a Polycletus. That's actually a very esoteric reference, because that's a better sculptor, one could argue. Shiner's citing not the philosopher, but the art historian classicist, whom we've seen already again, qua historian of ancient Greece and Rome. Thus, Shiner concludes by citing John Boardman's classic study of Greek art, Art for Art's Sake, was virtually an unknown concept. Boardman, who still lives, wrote, it's a very giant book of his, very serious book. There was neither a real art market nor collectors. All art had a function, and artists were suppliers of a commodity on a par, we see this again one more time, you see why Jacques Rancière likes this, with shoemakers. Okay. The next section, the beautiful, the true, the good. I've already mentioned Nehemas, and I might also mention the late Roger Scruton. A selection from his little book on beauty appears in the Hume collection on taste, reading David Hume's Of the Standard of Taste. And you can also see this, of course, gives us the reference to Nehemas, and right there in his hand, because I kind of gave it to him, is reading David Hume's Of the Standard of Taste in Princeton. Gave that to him about a year ago this month. The reflections we're here undertaking all depend on the notion of mimesis and the idea, as we see this in Plato, as well as form and the influence of morphological thinking in Aristotle, as this in turn is a matter of causality, as we may recall from Heidegger's reading of the fourfold of causation in his own Question Concerning Technology, a text which we might read just to get some back lit illumination on Heidegger's earlier lectures, which he gave three of these, Der Ursprung des Kunstwerkes, which published in 1960, had an introduction by Hans-Georg Gadamer. This is actually much smaller, this is a bigger book. If we recall Fried's reflection on Winckelmann, we already mentioned the title of the article, Antiquity Now, there's a question of rank order when it comes to the classical ideal, almost by definition, the quote, the most beautiful body among us, among the moderns, that's what Winckelmann is referring to, moderns in his day, would perhaps be as much inferior to the most beautiful Greek body as Iphicles, who was a cripple, was to his brother Hercules. Or one could actually say Iphicles and Heracles. As Fried goes on to say, in context exploring Winckelmann's very precise thoughts on imitation as guide for such modern artistry as such, for example, philosophers and artists alike frequented gymnasia where the young men of Greece exercised naked. Here are the Pancratists. The most beautiful youths danced unclothed in the theater, and numerous festivals provided the artist with the opportunity to familiarize himself with naked human beauty to the inestimable advantage of his art. To this extent, the reference is to Aristotle, and the issue here will be a matter of perfecting, that is to say, improving on nature. We would think of this if we were speaking of ancient Greek historians, of the reproach that it is or would be to make things better or grander than they were, in truth. But some historians did do that. And in poetry, that's our point, the lyric poet Archilochus makes when he observes that after an important battle, it always turns out that everyone who's at war will claim to have been at just that battle. As Fried writes, citing Winckelmann, this is the Gedanken über die Nachahmung der griechischen Werke in der Malerei und Bildhauer Kunst, Reflections, this peers the imitation on the painting and sculptures of the Greeks, kind of lost in the translation. The great, Fried writes, exemplary originary achievement of the ancient Greeks turns out to have been grounded in a recognition of the need to go beyond natural beauty in the direction of the ideal. These frequent opportunities, this is the citation from Winckelmann, to observe nature obliged the Greek artists to go a step further. They began to form certain general concepts of beauties more elevated than those of nature herself, concepts pertaining to single parts of the body as well as to the proportions of the whole frame. Their ideal was an immediately intuitable spiritual nature, eine bloß im Verstande entworfene geistige Natur. Okay. Now, here we have this idea of form and, of course, the door for us. The next reference is significant, as Winckelmann doesn't cite Aristotle, but much rather the painter. He doesn't talk about the sculpture, but the painter Raphael. As he writes about his 1514 completed Fried, who's an art historian, tells us that the frescoes painted during 1513, the triumph of Galatea. Now, famously, and a similar sentiment is also repeated among some of the ancients, to be sure, we're going to see echoes of this positive expression when it comes to love in Plato and the Phaedrus and the Symposium as well, which is well known in the Republic, whereby the ideal inspires and illuminates the features of the world and every beloved. Raphael, seeking to distract those who suspected him of painting his own beloved. This isn't as unimaginable as various art historians have debated this question. Some art historians emphasizing a very Platonic Raphael. We see that here. Some, the Italian art historian, you can see this is his beloved. And this is the Madonna Colonna. The Italian art historian, I have him here, Antonio Forcellino, insisting on rather more passion. One must put Nietzsche into the latter category, as Nietzsche too weighed in on this very debate. Was Raphael a kind of ascetic artist, or was he really sleeping with his models? Was he kind of, we could call him today a sexual harasser. We might want to do that. That is, after all, the baker's daughter is one of his models, also his lover. But for Nietzsche, Raphael would have exceeded limits in this respect, thinking, yes, as Nietzsche says, and doing, yes, and therefore not a Christian, which is, what do we have this reference here? To Galatea, an artist of abundant power, as opposed to the readings of those who think instead. Not contra the promise of happiness, which is always very erotic, but the need for ascetic discipline. How can you create works of this kind, as Raphael did? And that is why Raphael would be able to say that his Galatea would be modeled on no one but just an ideal of an ideal beauty so rare. Now, we have a slide here, which is Fried himself, although Raphael is cited to exemplify an approach to art associated with the ancients, the state of affairs alluded to in his letter that we've shown before, the extreme scarcity of beautiful human beings differs fundamentally from the situation with regard to bodily beauty that, according to Winckelmann, that is to say, according to what has gone before, prevailed in ancient Greece. Now, it's worth adding that just as one can miss an allusion to Plutarch, regarding Solon and Thales in Nietzsche, one can also fail to note, and Fried does not in fact note, what Winckelmann would have known, namely that Raphael in his letter was citing Pliny on Legacies. There's Pliny painting various different beauties in order to get an ideal beauty. A story also repeated in Cicero's De Inventione. He didn't think that he could find all the component parts, Cicero writes, of perfect beauty in one person. This is Zeuxis. Why? Because the same example, same answer that Raphael gives, claims for his part, nature has made nothing of any class absolutely perfect in every part. Here once again we have Raphael's Galatea. On Fried's page 94, we have an instructive footnote. For Philippe Lacoulabat, Fried writes, Winckelmann's central proposition amounts to a gigantic historical double bind. I think that's a reference to Rainer Schormann because the last phrase is in English. And as a consequence, bears the threat of psychosis. That's from Hödelin et les Grecs in Politique, which appears in 1979, as you can see there. In that article, Lacoulabat, this is Fried, contrasts what he takes to be Winckelmann's views in regard with those of Schiller, and especially Oederlin, for both of whom, as he, Lacoulabat, shows, the ostensibly antithetical terms of ancients and moderns turn out to be divided, riven by difference from, that's the key, within. Difference from within. The ideal of Schiller here, along with Hödelin and the vision of aesthetic education and achievement, goes together with an extraordinary return to the Greeks. My own teacher, the late Jacques Tamignou, would write his, this is an advanced dissertation, not his basic dissertation. He directed my own dissertation, which was a basic dissertation, on the nostalgia for Greece at the dawn of German idealism. And that included the ideal of the one differentiated within itself. Key here to all of this is Hödelin's epistolary novel, Hyperion, which is a novel in letters. Not unlike the notice, if we can remember that, that Lacoulabat makes with Schiller's own aesthetic letters. Hyperion, or the hermit in Greece, corresponds to the ideal of beauty for Schiller. And it will do to quote, I'd like to do that here, Roger Scruton, the late Roger Scruton, late Sir Roger Scruton, with the good, the true, and the useful, wrote Schiller, as Scruton cites him, man, the human being, der Mensch, is merely in earnest, but with the beautiful he plays. Now, the complicated example returns. How does Michelangelo sculpt his statues? Or at least Fried emphasizes, this is his Mimesis, what Winckelmann sees in Michelangelo's achievement as an imitation of the ancients, including an imitation of ancient practice. Now, the Vasari, as we know, we mentioned this in class, very literally tells us that Michelangelo sculpted a Cupid, took it to an art dealer, how much will you give me for this? And now we're back to the modern definition of art and the artists George Dickey and Dante. Institutionally speaking, is one an artist if one cannot sell one's works? A similar question might hold for an artisan, a stonecutter, to be sure. Michelangelo received time-honored advice that he'd do better to fabricate an authentic-looking fake. The art dealer helped him with that. And of course, one imagines he also helped with authenticating it and the process of its antiquing, an enterprise well known to Renaissance art dealers of the time. And it's still known to dealers of antiques in art shops in New England or England, London, up in Rhinebeck, if we're thinking of it from New York City, or just down in the village, when you used to have antique shops and such like, maybe they're open again. But fake it, Michelangelo did. And although we don't have the original fake, it was destroyed in a fire, we do have other samples, and museums actually abound in these. The tale is so well worn that Mark Twain made this into a little story, the capital line of Venus. And it's worth reading just his first line. So romantically transparent are they, and so relevant on the theme of mimesis and the Greeks, no less, complete with technico-mechanical stage directions. We read scene, an artist's studio in Rome. Oh, George, I do love you. Bless your dear heart, Mary, I know that. Why is your father so obdurate? You can see this would be the father here. It looks a little bit like Stephen Fry. George, he means well, but art is folly to him. He only understands groceries. He thinks you would starve me. Confound his wisdom. It savors of inspiration. Why am I not a money-making, bowelless grocer instead of a divinely gifted sculptor with nothing to eat? Do not despond, George G. Dear. All his prejudices will fade away as soon as you shall have acquired $50,000. And suddenly, an interruption. 50,000 demons, child. I'm in arrears for my board. Now, notice how this neatly fits on the page, so we miss the closing line. It's a matter of some contention still when it comes to the provenance of the Laocoon. Here we have a difference, one of those sleeping cupids, a marble snake, which can perhaps give us a clue. And in class, we noted that statues that Winckelmann praised as ancient, paradigmatically Greek and Roman have been downgraded by scholars in recent years. They've been dated as later works, and by definition, lesser works. Remember Vasari's little story. And a lot of scholarship, including at Columbia University and down at NYU, the Laocoon would appear to be next on the list of fallen antiquities, in which fall, as it turns out, he was present when the Laocoon was unearthed or discovered. Michelangelo looms large. But even this downgrading is all about mimesis. There are higher significances in addition, and these, beyond Michelangelo's copies, take us to the theological aesthetic as such. Once again, mimesis, which involves imitation or representation for those interested in more theological articulation, involves memorialization or even garden variety copying, which was exactly the problem that Plato had with the representation of a general or a warrior or an Oedipus when he challenges the rhapsode Ion with respect to his poetic achievements in the dialogue on the Ion. As Fried writes, what becomes apparent, however, if we're to take seriously the pages in question, is that the conceptually elusive enterprise he's talking about, Winckelmann, that Winckelmann calls imitation specifically involves a moment of copying, namely the operation by which the model in wax or plaster is brought over, this is the transposing, into marble and so made permanent. Indeed, there's an important sense in which that moment of copying emerges as decisive for, if not constitutive of, the very enterprise of imitation. Now, it's more complicated, but if we've been able to note how very important it is to attend to thinkers we don't always note, and that we already did as we began with the very first author of an aesthetica, an aesthetics, Baumgarten, to the extent that this is a book more of a reference than actually read, which is the fate of many classics, especially those written in Latin. But not only those, we can also consider, and we're going to try and do that, Plotinus himself. Squarely his mimesis and diegesis, narration, imitation, in the Neoplatonic tradition. Think of Plato once again with his hand pointing upward at the heaven of forms or ideas. Plato contrasts mimesis, the imitative aspect of drama or show and tell, as we might say, as opposed to narrative communication via indirect speech and the he said sort of thing, diegesis. Thus, contrasting mimesis, we get an illumination of today's standard accounts of narratology, and not less historiography, as Ugolini, Gerardo Ugolini, can tell us, reading as he does between Herodotus and Thucydides. Famously, Plato has a problem with mimesis. It's for him dangerous, twice removed from truth and seductive. Think of the woman of Amphisa here to boot. Recall that in the Republic, Plato only brings in the notion of drama, which was so essential in ancient Greece, as we may remember, including actors and mimes, mimetai, after the city has already become swollen in luxury to a city of pigs. That means we've left the earlier distinction made between the religious meaning of ritual imitation. Here, Solon's Alma Tadema gives us the pre-Raphaelite vision of sybaritic lounging recuperation, 1887. Or we could also consider this as a copy, an imitation of Baldassare Peruzzi, Apollo and the Muses dancing, which one can see in Attingham Park. And that means that the notion is left well behind by the time we get to Plato, or as Nietzsche insists, by the time we get to Socrates. So to illuminate Plato on the beautiful, remember the Republic, and not less, the Symposium, as well as the Phaedrus, and perhaps indirectly, we have, of course, the Symposium here, Anselm Feuerbach's first version, the 1869 version of the Gastmahl. Notice how dark it is, and here is a detail. We can see kind of an Arthur Danto-like sleeping Socrates in the corner, and beautiful torches illuminating the inside of this villa. And the later version, which is much more golden, Das Gastmahl, it is Platon, 1874. So if we cite the Aeneids of Plotinus, just with the one, two slides here on the Symposium and the Phaedrus, this is obviously the Phaedrus. And again, the Phaedrus, the tripartite nature of the soul. We have the Aeneids right here, Plotinoi, right, that we see here. Pleasure and distress, he says. Fear and courage, desire and aversion. Where have these affections and experiences their seat? And the question then is, it could be in the soul, or it could be one notion, the soul is employing the body, or some third entity which would derive from both. And again, there could be a blend, or there could be, which would be a kind of a mixture, or it could be something that would be distinct from the same blending. As Plotinus goes on to say, the influence of this is already plain, even if it can seem to have been forgotten in what we were reading just a little bit before in Thomas Pufer, who cited Aristotle, and as if the Neoplatonists, and especially Plotinus, had never needed to be considered, because this, of course, is one of the great problems of attempting to add context, as we can go back to a certain historical frame and thereby, and perhaps innocently, overlook the historical context in its breadth. So this can be to our peril if we wish, as we do, to consider the medieval tradition, but also, as we saw, we were mentioning Panofsky, architecture as such, and the very notion of what Panofsky, this is of course not an accidental in sort of modernist mimesis or imitation of not Michelangelo, but Leonardo da Vinci. As Plotinus writes, and here it's evident why he is a Neoplatonic thinker, for it is to the gods, not to the good, that our likeness must look. To model ourselves upon good men is to produce an image of an image. We have to fix our gaze above the image and attain likeness to the supreme exemplar. The same ideal that, as we already noted, Michael Fried describes in his comments on imitation and Winckelmann is also here. This is the so-called great chain of being. Here you see the marvelous hand coming down from the cloud that we otherwise can recognize and see the same up here in the chain. And of course, all the people who don't quite make it and those who do. And Michelangelo reproduces that motif without the rest, just sort of abstracted on the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel. And we see that with the genius of an artist like Michelangelo, a genius who painted as he sculpted on commission, that is, everything he did for pay. He was, like Socrates, a stonecutter by trade, and Socrates, you know, neglected his work, and he neglected to get paid, as his wife would complain. And if we seek a paradigm for music as an art, we have it in Plotinus, where it's otherwise rarely discussed. Schopenhauer is an exception, Nietzsche too, Adorno likewise. And therefore, this is going to matter with a reference to the musician. This is Plotinus. We may think of the musician as being exceedingly quick to beauty, and there's almost a parallel also to what David Hume is going to be talking about. Drawn in a very rapture to it, somewhat slow to stir of his own impulse, he answers at once to the outer stimulus, as the timid are sensitive to noise, so he to tones and the beauty they convey. All that offends against unison or harmony in melodies and rhythms repels him. He longs for measure and shapely pattern. The reference to music is key. We got Apollo here with his lyre. And we read, as we can almost hear the same in Gunther Anders, the first cousin of Walter Benjamin, student of Heidegger, first husband of Arendt. I have to say all this because we mostly haven't heard of Anders. And not everyone has read Adorno on music. This natural tendency must be made the starting point to such a man. He must be drawn by the tone, rhythm, and design in things of sense. He must learn to distinguish the material forms from the authentic existent, which is the source of all correspondences and of the entire reason scheme in the work of art. He must be led to the beauty that manifests itself through these forms. If this is the one in terms of Platonic and Plotinian emanations, when we get to Adorno, but very explicitly when we get to Anders, and of course I'm speaking around the epoch of the High Holidays, and that's of course Rosh Hashanah, Anders takes the call to listen, the Shema, hear, O Israel, the Lord is one. But Plotinus tells us how via harmony this call to listen to the listener, as Adorno says, to the geneigte Leser, we saw that with Baumgarten as he begins his Metaphysica, actually works. He has to be shown harmony. What ravished him, this is something that needs instruction, was no other than the harmony of the intellectual world and the beauty in that sphere. Not some one shape of beauty, but all beauty, the absolute beauty. And the truths of philosophy must be implanted in him to lead him to faith in that which, unknowing it, he possesses within himself. Now, Plotinus explains, using music of all things, not literature, not painting, not sculpture, but the philosopher, saying the philosopher is a lover, lover of wisdom, the born lover, to whose degree the musician also may attain, and then either come to a stand or pass beyond, has a certain memory of beauty, but severed from it now, he no longer comprehends it. Spellbound by a visible loveliness, he clings amazed about that. Here, we're reminded of the soul's ascent, which for another religious conviction may also be named the pilgrim's progress. This would be transformed in Nietzsche to the wanderer in his converse with his shadow. And that is now in a modern disenchanted world. At the end of the 19th century, Adorno's aesthetic theory will expand that by little more than a third of the century as we read. This is per contra. This is a warning from Plotinus. And here we have the soul's ascent in St. John Climacus. We saw that a little bit before. See the hand again. His lesson must be to fall down no longer in bewildered delight before some one embodied form. He must be led under a system of mental discipline to beauty everywhere and made to discern the one principle underlying all, a principle apart from the material forms, springing from another source and elsewhere more truly present. We're reminded of Plato, as we might also recall Baumgarten before his Aesthetica, which is Metaphysica. So we read the metaphysician, equipped by that very character, winged already, and not like those others in need of disengagement, stirring of himself towards the supernal, but doubting of the way, needs only a guide. He must be shown then, and instructed a willing wayfarer by his very temperament, all but self-directed. Now, that reminds us a bit of Plato's Phaedrus, in that this is patently Christian at the same time. This is neo plainly so, therefore, already in the new era post, that is to say, Christian era, isn't a surprise, unless this is the basis for theological aesthetics to this day, whether we read Scouten or von Hildebrandt or von Balthasar. Plotinus writes, we behold that all the loveliness of this world comes by communion in ideal form. That's just very, very beautiful. And now we quote Aeneid 6:3, which is arguably behind the loveliest definition of music as architecture in tones and harmonies unheard in sound create the harmonies we hear and wake the soul to the consciousness of beauty, showing it the one essence in another kind. For the measures of our sensible music are not arbitrary, but are determined by the principle whose labor is to dominate matter and bring pattern into being. But the religious focus, the Platonic focus, you can see that here, remains. This is no call to appreciate musical events or operatic moments of high culture of the sort Scouten and others endorse, for all their fondness for such old ideals. As we read in Aeneid 6:8, if we go on, he that has the strength, let him arise and withdraw into himself, forgoing all that is known by the eyes, turning away forever from the material beauty that once made his joy. The best image is the one that follows here, echoing the Stoic ideal as it does of self-reflection, self-retreat, and quoted by both Michelangelo, who liberates the form that slumbers in the stone, and that other artist, the bodybuilder, think of Arnold Schwarzenegger. We can see him here with Frank Zane, remembering that bodybuilding used to be the activity of physical culture, as it's called in France, and the bodybuilder, this language, was the convention in New York in the 40s and 50s, late 40s, mid-50s, would be a workout artist, withdrawn to yourself and look. And if you do not find yourself beautiful yet, act as does the creator of a statue that is to be made beautiful. He cuts away here, he smooths there, he makes this line lighter, this other purer, until a lovely face has grown upon his work, and the face in question is the surface that is formed. We're back to Band. Citing Baumgarten and his rock, we're back to the negative framing of the process of sculpting that Winkelmann describes, as Fried cites him in describing Michelangelo's sculptor's process. But Plotinus goes on, and we get the same image that will recur in Kant, as we may also read it in Nietzsche, and of course in one friend of Foucault, and that would have been Pierre Hadot. Labor to make all one glow of beauty and never cease chiseling your statue. So do you also cut away all that's excessive, straight, and all that's crooked, bring light to all that's overcast, labored to make all one glow of beauty, and never cease chiseling your statue, until there shall shine out on you from it the godlike splendor of virtue, until you shall see the perfect goodness surely established in the stainless shrine. Now, there's another slide, and we're just going to touch a little bit on Adorno's Mimesis, but we're not going to go very far. It gives us Dionysus, but not the Dionysus we've been talking about, but pseudo-Dionysus, Dionysius, the Areopagite, visible things or images of invisible things. Phenomenal beauties become images of invisible beauty.